Assalamu alaikum and hello everyone. And this is the lecture number 19, which is the last lecture on the series of lectures of thanatology. As we have been discussing in the previous lecture, various methods determining time since death. So in this last lecture, I will discuss the concurrence method of determining time since death, which means various processes which have been happening concurrently within the body and in the circumstances, and these circumstantial evidences also help us in determining time since death. For example, body is lying in the lawn of some house and the grass underneath has turned yellow, and we come to know that since how long this body has been lying there and how much time it takes to turn the green grass into yellow. So this is one example. So there are many other circumstantial evidences within the body and outside the body in these circumstances which help us in determining time since death. So this is what is known as concurrence method of determining time since death. So I am discussing this lecture in these things in the upcoming lecture. Okay. Hello everyone. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So now I'm starting with the last lecture number 19 of the series of thanatology. And the learning objective of this lecture will be that we will discuss the second method of determination of time since death, and which is the concurrence method. The concurrence method determining for the time since death. And in this lecture, we will understand that what are various changes which are going on concurrently within the body and outside the body as circumstantial evidence, like the contents of the stomach, the feces in the intestine, the presence of urine in the urinary bladder, and other circumstantial evidences or changes going on concurrently outside the body, like growth of hair on the face, presence of lice in the hair, the state of dress of the individual, personal effects, and other data we'll discuss in this lecture. And these all will help us in determination of time since death. So the concurrence method of determination of time since death. This is also a circumstantial evidence. Some events are going on concurrently, and we study these processes which are going on in the surrounding or within the body and correlated regarding its timing. Like the contents of the stomach, the feces in the intestine, the presence of urine in the urinary bladder, and other circumstantial evidences are like the growth of hair on the face, presence of lice in the hair, state of dress, personal effects, and other data. Like the contents of the stomach and bowel, the state of digestion of the contents of the stomach help us in determining the hour of death in relation to the last meal. If the time when the last meal was taken is known, the time elapsed since death can be estimated. Sometimes the stomach contents can be matched with that particular meal. And the length of the time required to empty the stomach after a meal is very variable. And it depends upon the type of meal, condition of the stomach, pyloric emptying, and psychological state of the person. Fear and anxiety may cause great delay in emptying time, and the process of digestion may remain suspended for a long time in shock and coma. So these factors should be kept in mind. Time calculation from the stomach contents. Ordinary mixed food takes approximately 4 to 6 hours to leave the stomach. So we can have idea between the last meal and the death on examination of the contents of the stomach, in which state of digestion they are. And this will again depend upon the nature of food, the condition of the stomach, healthy or diseased. Regarding the time of food and gastric emptying, like milk leaves stomach rapidly. The large vegetables do not leave before 4 hours. And chapati, it converts into pulp in 2 hours. And the dals are pulses of all kinds. They remain recognizable up to 2 hours. The rice up to 3 hours. The meat with vegetable, it is recognizable up to 3 hours. All vegetables up to 4 hours. So in general, if at autopsy one finds that stomach is full and food is recognizable, then it would suggest that the victim had died within 2 hours of taking last meal, if the food was distinguishable. And at 4 hours, if the food was indistinguishable. The nature of food is also important. If the bread is found in the stomach, it may indicate that the victim died after the breakfast. And if chapatis, rice, dal are found, then he died after meal, lunch, or the dinner. It must be remembered that the process of digestion may not cease at death. Indeed, the enzymes released due to autolysis may digest even the stomach wall, resulting in perforation. Regarding the presence of feces in the intestine, the presence and absence of feces in the large intestine may give some indication about the time of the incidence. As it is customary to evacuate the bowel in the morning. So if the bowel is full of feces, one may presume that the death could have occurred sometimes in the night. And if it is empty, then sometimes after evacuation in the morning. Then regarding the contents of the urinary bladder, the amount of urine in the bladder may also give some indication of the time since last micturation. Normally, the kidneys secrete about 50 ounces of urine a day. Since it is customary to evacuate the bladder at night before going to bed, and the presence of urine in the urinary bladder may indicate that the death could have occurred sometimes late in the night. Then other circumstantial evidences. The growth of hair on the face. Males generally shave the chin every day. And the beard hair grow at about 0.4 millimeter per day. From this, a rough estimation may be made of the time of last shave. Hair do not grow after death. And if the hair seems prominent, that is usually due to contraction of the muscle and the hair becoming prominent. It is not the growth of the hair after death. Now the flies, we study the life cycle and we study the various stages and then estimate the time since death. This is also circumstantial evidence. In 18 to 36 hours after death, the flies are attracted and they lay eggs. Eggs hatch into larvae or maggots in next 24 hours. And in 4 to 5 days, they develop into pupa. And in next 4 to 5 days, the pupa changes to adult fly. So we examine in which stage the larva, the pupa, or the adult fly, if they are coming, we can estimate the time since death from that. Then regarding the presence of lice, lice is generally found on long hairs of the head and maybe in short hairs and other parts of the body. And the lice generally die within 3 to 6 days after death. So if the lice are alive, we can estimate the time that it may be less than 3 to 6 days, or if they are dead, then it may be more than 6 days. Then the state of dress of the individual. Dress may indicate whether the person was in office dress, night dress, uniform, and so on. So this can give an idea that in which state of the dress the person was. Then other personal effects. The wristwatch, letters, diary, food lying in the circumstances, they all provide a valuable data regarding the time of incidence of that particular crime. Like the socioeconomic background, the businessman, the office executive, and so on. So these are personal habits or personal finding give us the idea about the socioeconomic background of the individual. Then other circumstantial evidences. If the body was in a room and the lights were on, it indicates that the death might have occurred at night. If the body was lying on green grass and the grass becomes pale due to non-exposure of sunlight on the area which the body is lying in, and it is usually in about 5 days. So the pale grass under the dead body suggests that the body is lying here for more than 5 days. So this is a circumstantial evidence, and this helps us in determining time since death. So the summary of all these findings is that regarding time since death and the condition of the body after 12 hours, rigor mortis seems fully developed. Postmortem staining has fixed, and green patch may appear in the right iliac fossa with start of putrefaction. Then after 24 to 36 hours, the rigor mortis is in passing off state, and the abdomen and chest, they are distended with gas. Ova of flies can be seen. And after 48 hours, the trunk is bloated, face discolored and swollen, blisters start appearing, and move the maggots may be seen moving on the body. Then after 72 hours, the whole body has been bloated and disfigured. The hair and the nail can be easily detached, and tissues are softening. In 1 to 2 weeks, the soft tissue viscera have been putrefied. Only more resistant viscera will be distinguishable. In 1 to 3 months, soft tissue gone and body is skeletonized. It must be remembered that these times are average time based on the evaluation of the postmortem changes. They give us an idea for the range of the time, and they apply in tropical climate. In cold weather, they must be doubled or tripled. That means twice time or the thrice the time of normal changes to appear. Therefore, the alleged time of death, it is not a reliable criteria. Only we can have an idea, studying various changes, and an average time is calculated from those changes which are occurring in the body. And the time refers to undisturbed and unmutilated bodies. The insect, birds, wild animals can skeletonize a body quickly. So this is all about the lecture. Now the summary of this lecture is that we have understood the second method of determination of time since death, which is the concurrence method. And we have learned in this that by studying the changes which are going on concurrently within the body and outside the body help us in determining time since death, like the contents in the stomach, contents in the intestine, presence of urine in the urinary bladder, and other circumstantial evidences like growth of hair, presence of lice, state of dress, personal effects, and other data. So they all help us in determination of time since then. Thank you very much. So this is all about the topic of thanatology, and this was the last lecture. I hope you have understood, because this lecture is basically the basic knowledge for the students and the young doctors. And if you like this video, please share it, subscribe it, and ask the other colleagues and fellows to subscribe and share. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.